This video will demonstrate how to achieve multi-node redundancy using Node-RED. Here we've got a few Raspberry Pis, and as I unplug the master, the next Pi takes over. You can see as I toggle the switch, the output's changing, and this is easily scalable to more nodes, and because Node-RED is so portable, these nodes could be BeagleBones or Wago PLCs just as easily as Raspberry Pis. We'll be using four Raspberry Pi 3Bs for this. There's a couple PoE hats on the market. This is a third-party one, and of course there's the official Raspberry Pi PoE hat as well. We'll be using a Wago 352 coupler with 8-in, 8-out for our Modbus I.O. And to top it off, we'll be using the new Wago 5-port DinRail mount Ethernet switch with 4 PoE ports. So we'll start by plugging in the PoE hat onto the Raspberry Pi 3. We'll do that for all 4 Raspberry Pis, and then we'll go ahead and attach them to the DinRail. Next, we'll supply the Ethernet cables for each of the Pis, and this is actually powering the Pi, so we don't have to worry about the USB connections. Here you can see all the link lights. So to save time, I've already installed the latest version of Raspbian Lite Image and Node-RED on all 4 Raspberry Pis, and you can see the static IPs have been set as shown in this diagram. Now using a web browser, we'll connect to the first node's Node-RED instance and use the Palette Manager to install a few nodes. We'll start by installing the Modbus node, which is going to be used to talk to our remote I.O. Once that's installed, then we need to install a package called IP, and this will give you the IP address of the local node. That's what we're using to identify on the network. We'll also need a node called N2N. This will publish information like broadcasting it over the network. And we'll need dashboard to create a nice user interface to see what's going on with the project. I don't show this, but you'll want to go into all the other nodes and repeat that same process so that they all have the same nodes installed. Now I'm pasting in my program example. This is the multi-master example on Node-RED, and I've got my 4 tabs open, and I'm just pasting the same program into all 4 instances of Node-RED. The way this works is the highest number IP is identified as the master. If that goes offline, then after a second or two, the next highest will take over. So you can see it says slave to 15 there in the middle. That's how you can identify who's the master when you're looking at the slave. If it is the master, it will say it's the master. So as I unplug each master Pi, the next Pi takes over as the master, and the controls are redundant because the same program is running in effect. As we'll get into the details, you'll see that there's the ability to pass actually variable parameters as well. So if you have timers or set presets that need to be acted upon when the next Pi takes over as the master, that's also possible to achieve with this application. So now you can see we're down to 1 Pi. So if we plug all the Pis back in, then when they boot up, they're actually set to run the Node-RED when it boots up again. So I've fast-forwarded it here a little bit so you can see now the highest Pi on the network, which is 15 in this case, has taken over as the master. And if I unplug all of them, then we no longer have any control, so the output's no longer coming on. So another way to look at this is using the dashboard. I'm going to delete the master node's flow, and I'm going to import a flow that has some more diagnostics in it. So you can see here we're actually keeping track of some key parameters in the application and then publishing them on this web interface. So you can actually see all of the messages coming in for all 4 nodes, and you can see what the node IP addresses are and what the local node is and whether this node is the master or not and who is the master. So if I unplug node 1, which is number 12, you'll see the elapsed time will start to increase here for this light blue. And if I plug it back in, and I fast forwarded it here, but when it boots back up, it starts transmitting again and it starts updating its new elapsed time between messages. Let's take a look at how the flow works. First thing you need is to inject a 1. This is done when the flow first starts. And then we're going to repeat that every 250 milliseconds to initiate the process. Our process variable contains all of our data that's needed in the control. And then we're transmitting out to the network as well, that process information. IP gets the IP address, and then here we're creating a global context with that information that's used in some of the other nodes. And then we're publishing that to the pins, which are can be used for other things in the program. We're grabbing the IPv4 address, and we're creating a payload that matches what the end-to-end creates, and that's being fed down below here. So here's we're receiving every 250 milliseconds data on the network. Here you can see this is where the nodes are processed as they come in, and we're cataloging every node that we see and by its IP address and getting its timestamp of when that message arrived. Then we parse out the IP address to find out what its last octet is. This is how we identifying the master. And then we're looking at the timestamp to determine whether that is still alive or not. That's all published into a nice JSON and sent out to the next node, which is to determine who's the master. It's using some variables here to keep track of who the master is. It starts by setting itself as the master, and then as it goes through this for loop, it's looking at that JSON array of nodes, and then if there's a higher number, then it's assumes the role of a slave. We're keeping track of how many times the node takes over as master. That's kind of useful if we're seeing a lot of switching happening. And then our read node, every 100 milliseconds, we're reading the inputs. Here's where we're doing some master controls. If we are the master on this node, then we are going to be doing our write. And then here's our single force coil to the first output. So real simple application. Let's look at some debug so you can see what the flows actually look like. We'll start by looking at what we're actually transmitting. This is what the local node is transmitting to the flow down below. So you can see here we're mimicking, like I said, what the end-to-end publishes. So we've got our payload with our process data, the IP address, which is our local IP address in this case. Then let's connect that to the end-to-end to see what it receives from all the other nodes. You can see here we're getting, you know, all the data from the other PLCs. You can see 15, you can see 13, and all the payloads are the same, but again, you know, have to add some JSON to add whatever variables you would need in your application. Let's connect the message node up to the process output. Like I said, this creates a JSON cataloging all of the nodes that it's seen data come in from. So if I just stop this, you can see here we've got four nodes. If you wanted to add more nodes, you could scale this up real easily. Just have to create more variables and enlarge the array. The ET is the elapsed time. That's how long it has been since the last time it heard from that node. So you can see, you know, 300 milliseconds, 800 milliseconds. Again, these are all, it's all adjustable based on that transmit send block, the purple one up above. And then if I look at the who is master block, the second output is basically just a true false, which is used to trigger and count how many times this node's taken over as master. And then the other pins on this block are used for statistics. So I hope you've enjoyed this proof of concept of how you can implement multi-node redundancy using Node-RED. Thank you.